Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to introduce Architect Gautama and Architect Janani to all of you. Both of them passed out from Avi College. Gautama was before that, he did a civil engineering and then joined architecture. So the clash is not so strong with architecture and the civil engineering, especially with Gautama. And he's been, both of them has been exploring various idioms of design, thought, and experimenting a lot with various notions of design and design execution. And it's a pleasure to have both of them here, and really looking forward for an amazing exploration of their works. And I've seen some works of Manhattan's, and really beautiful experimental work, exploring materials and structural systems to another level. And I'm really looking forward to listening from them. Over to you, Gautama.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for a wonderful introduction. Yeah. I just want to tell you, share a story here. What happened, I think, a year before, I think 2-3 years before, we had a client. He had an issue because it's, so with the compound wall, he wanted a very extraordinary compound wall. He asked us, like, you know, can we, because it was on a busy road, he wanted us to, like, you know, treat that compound wall with some kind of, you know, communal motifs on that, because, you know, the chances of people urinating on the wall and they're going to
you all must have seen this kind of motifs on many compound walls,
so
right?
This is the issue.
As you have gone around the city, you see people put small photographs of different gods of different religions. So these are very all kinds of small tiles. So he also wanted us to design his compound wall like that. But we were wondering, is there any other secular way to solve this issue?
We thought of, okay, how to resolve it. So that is when we started thinking. So why I'm talking about all these things, so this kind of research are required, like, you know, this kind of you have to start thinking, we have to throw questions, how to resolve.
So the social issue was people are urinating on the walls, so how can we solve it in a more secular way? We started thinking maybe we can just put some signs saying way to toilet, like just arrow marks leading to the nearest toilet. So
we did that experiment, and but it ended up somewhere next door, so they started complaining and they started putting an U-turn arrow marks. So that didn't solve the problem. So there was the next thing, like, you know, how to resolve. So we thought of actually, you know, going with the reflective walls. So that completely changed the entire scenario over there, the issue completely. So we are able to solve the issue in a very secular way, I can say that. So that really, like, you know, this kind of thought process, like, you know, these kind of thought process, like, you know, help us to resolve things laterally. And we started implementing similar ideas in many of the design, so which I'm going to explain shortly. And Janani, yeah.
We are looking at the practice and research. Is there a way to overlap? Is there a way to bridge the connection between this research and practice? Is it necessary? Well, if so, what are the advantages? So these are some of the things we'll be discussing today, along with some examples from our own practice. So typically when we think about research, we think about academic research, like people sitting and working on something in a very theoretical way. But today what research we are going to talk about is more of a research through practice. So it is like the research itself has evolved through our own practice. So how does this happen? So we have this first phase called as the exploration. So whatever is the issue, we begin with exploration, lateral thinking. What are the other alternatives possible? And we do a brainstorming as a team, as a network. And we question down to the very basics, whatever the issue is. And then slowly that is implemented at the project site. And again, this goes back to the design exploration. After the project has been executed, we review what has happened at the site. we see whether it has solved the issue. Is there any improvisation possible? Is there any innovation possible? So it is a very ongoing, continuous process. We go back to design exploration and it's back and forth. So we'll just start with a small case where we were exploring with what we can do for a fixed glazing. So that is our design problem. We have to design a fixed glazing for a multi-dwelling residential unit, and the intention is to just get light in. But then we have certain design criteria with which we'll start. We do not want to use any grills, and we want the structure to be lightweight.
The structural cover, like, you know, the glass entity should also structurally, you know, a structural component.
Itself a structural element.
Because we wanted to transfer some amount of the load through that. There was another criteria over there. And next is the aesthetic appealing and how to reduce the dead load also. That was another challenge what we had.
To some extent, we can reduce our dependency on new materials. Is upcycling a possibility? So with all this, we were thinking, what is this kind of alternative or exploration we can do in the glazing design? So that is when we started working on bottle walls or masonry where bottles, glass bottles are embedded. So as you can see, this was the first time we did it. We did it using flavored Nandini milk bottles.
Actually, the weight of those bottles are very less and doesn't really go back to the the recycling unit.
Milk bottles as a replacement for fixed masonry, fixed glass within the masonry, and it also led to reducing the dead weight on the structure because glass was replacing the concrete element there and getting in the light. But then we wanted to improvise this further as part of our exploration. We wanted to see whether we can place the bottles in a different format. So we'll just go to the next exploration. What we did was we were seeing that is there a better way to pack the bottles in a more tighter way so as to get more bottles within the same panel. That is when we started packing them in a hexagonal format. So each circle is surrounded by six bottles. Each bottle is surrounded by six bottles. This time we started using beer bottles because it was winter and people were giving us more of beer bottles in our campaigns. We were collecting used bottles from people. But then what happened, still we were not happy that we were using concrete as the infill material. So we wanted to experiment with something else. That's then we tried rammed earth, and in that the bottles.
Basically, the resource what is consumed in the rammed earth wall. We can use all this kind of, we can reduce the soil content and we can actually use the bottle in between wherever you wanted to replace the fixed windows or you want little amount of light inside, you can use such kind of walls. And these walls can also work as your load bearing wall itself, you know, because the load transfers in a different, in a different pattern itself. Like, it actually, every bottle acts like a small arch openings in a wall. And that's how it transfers the load. Yeah, I'll just take a pointer. So if you look at that load distribution will happen in a very different way. So it will transfer here and then again, it will move on to the other one. So we can reduce the resource. So that is how the filling material can happen inside the load bearing walls. So you can think of such material and techniques, to bring down the resource, basically the amount of soil or whatever resource.
In this particular exercise, we involved some students.
I'm just trying to explain you the research part here, the kind of process, with respect to the materials, what kind of research you can do on.
There is a lot that one can explore, various facets of that concept we try to explore. So another thing we did with bottles after that, then we were seeing how we can use it not only in the walls but also on the roof as skylights. So in this case, we already had an existing pergola in this particular residence. So, but they wanted to cover it up. So instead of just putting a glass skylight, we tried this sort of arrangement. So it promoted the upcycling as well as it brought some colored light. Some of the research, what we have done in building technology, we'd like to talk about. So the first thing is in the flat roof system. So what are the alternatives or explorations we can do in a flat roofing system when we were seeing? And this project actually was a school project where we started with here with the design of the entrance canopy. It's about 30 feet by 10 feet, 12 feet canopy. So we were saying, how can we do a roof which consumes a substantially less amount of concrete and steel, but still it's a flat roof? So that's when we started with this concept called as the brick flat funicular roof. So these bricks, what you see here, this portion, these circles, what you see there is no use of concrete or steel. So they are actually embedded in the slab and they stand by arch action by their own. They're structurally stable elements, each of these circular concentric circles you see. So this
basically it will be in a funnel shaped. So the funnel, what happens, like, you know, I've conducted a lot of workshop on this.
See that in the next one also, yeah. I'll show you. You want to talk about the structural system, right?
Yeah, this is a kind of a, like suspended umbrella kind of structure. The entire structure is 30 feet by 12 feet and weighs more than, because the entire 6 inches concrete, it's really very heavy, in fact. And we have only three columns in center, and it is, the entire roof is held from the top.
So it's a very light feel.
Very interesting entry, and I will explain you. And this is another interesting snap. I can give you. There is no connect of. It is not connected with the slab itself. The columns are not connected to the slab. It is actually suspended from top. Here, the whole objective was not to use any kind of steel and concrete. Everything should work without the steel and concrete over there. So we thought of going with. If you can see in this image, very.
Except for the beams, most of the slab, more than about 60%, there was a reduction in the concrete and the steel by use of these this particular roofing system. And also the advantage is it's flat. So it's not an arch. You don't have to fill the top with a new material. So it is quite easy that way.
It's not a conical structure as well. It's a flat kind of roof.
But then still we wanted to do some improvisation because you can see there is still some amount of element of steel here. So that is when what we started doing. We started looking on what are the other shapes or other forms where we can have this funicular roof system. Why does it only have to be a circle? What happens if we connect different shapes, a triangle, a semicircle? We even tried for a square, rectangle and all that.
Or in some cases, we even amalgamated different shapes to get an interesting roof forms. You can even have a longer spans using connecting different shapes, amalgamating different shapes to the geometries. Like circle, you can add another circle, combining with another circle. So we can actually increase the spans also. That is also we have experimented. So the kind of experience you get from these kind of material properties and these kind of techniques are really amazing, if you look at the previous slide, the entry approach itself is very interesting that way.
And also the student community, the architectural community, as you saw, we conducted many workshops on this particular technique, where they're all hands-on, so students get real-time experience and confidence on how to use it. So slowly, we want to get these kind of techniques into the mainstream from the niche.
They're not really rocket science,
Yeah, they're all very easy, actually. They're not as tough as it may seem in the beginning. And want to talk about thermocol concrete.
This is another interesting component. We always know, in some sunken areas or in the bathroom areas and all, we fill cinder. So that's a lightweight material, So we wanted to replace those material with some other alternative materials. So thermocol concrete was another interesting product. We experimented and we brought it to the mainstream of practice.
It was dancing the thermocol which was lying waste again. So there's a lot of waste thermocol which are thrown in and around the city. So from there we've amalgamated some thermocol and it was used to form these blocks. Yeah. So these blocks, as you can see, they float.
I'll give you another example. If you look at the jack arch, this is an arch panel roof. I don't call this a jack arch roof. This is an arch panel roof. Usually you see in many projects, you know, many of the architects uses, I mean, these techniques for the roof. So this upper area, you can see, also see some values here. So this can also be filled with a lightweight material. So it will reduce the dead load. In turn, you know, it will also reduce the load on the rafters and makes the building, you know, more cost effective that way.
And also, in turn, replaces the concrete. So that way, we'll be reducing our dependence on concrete there. Then talking about the stabilized mud block, so although it is already stabilized mud block is a kind of a common material, a lot of people are using it, but what we did something differently on the site is we actually converted a cutting machine into a thermocol, into a mud block making machine at site, mainly because
basically even a metal sheet cutting machine, which you can all convert now for a, you know, the block making machines, in fact, by yourself. So that was really interesting.
Because we had to make many bricks for this particular project. So it was more economic for us to have this machine at site rather than procuring the blocks from somewhere else. And also the soil was also used from the site. So it was very local. We, even the production happened at site.
Interlocking blocks, what we did.
Two side interlocking blocks. They interlock on the both axes. And they're hollow. As you can see, there are holes here. So here you can see we have made eight sample blocks, each of different composition, that which is the cement, the sand, the lime, the earth. So all of this, the proportion of it varies in these blocks, and then we sent them for testing. So we did these empirical tests before deciding which is the best block to use for the particular project.
We did a lot of research on material and techniques of concern. And
here the blocks are also combining. You can see how they are, you know, it doesn't require mortar, these blocks actually. So you can see that it is combining in both the axes because of these grooves that are provided this way as well as
X and Y axis.
Yeah, this way also.
So I'm going to talk about another technique what we have explored more. That's ecodome.
Structure basically ecodome, maybe some of you have heard of it already. It doesn't require a separate a roof. It's not a wall and a roof kind of structure, but an entire thing is like a dome. So the same earth bag is the material that is used for the entire building. So the same thing becomes your roof. It's a dome.
There are a lot of challenges, like different issues we face, like, you know, when you start compressing these bags, you know, what happens, you know, the elasticity of the material, I mean, the bags, you know, it'll expand, and because of the weight, many challenges. It looks very simple, but we resolved many issues there at site level itself, because these bags, when you start ramming these bags, it'll all expand, and it will break also sometimes. So how to resolve it, like, you know, how to understand what is the maximum compression it is achieved, all that, you know, it's a challenges.
Technique in terms of thing that a community can build this by itself. It doesn't require it's like more of a community building kind of a detail where people come together and they fill these bags with earth, the HDPE bags or hemp bags. We fill it with earth and we ram it, and we kind of design on the go. Actually, everything was not fixed. It's not like it's on paper. On site itself, many decisions are made, and people come together and they learn and work together. So that is how this project was done. So you can see how the earth is filled into the bags, and then it's rammed. And we used, in fact, concrete rings as for the windows.
Temporary formwork
for the windows.
So apart from this material and techniques, the research, like, you know, we have done research in different areas, like, you know, how we can take the architecture to the next level. And not just limited to the individual villas or multi-dwelling residence or a commercial build. Apart from that, you know, how we can now take it to the next level.
In urban context,
in a larger sector, like, you know. So that is when we pitched in an idea called Symbiotic Shelter that was incubated in the Institute of Science, by Management, Bangalore, NSRCL, NS Raghavan Center for Entrepreneurship Learning. So that's a platform where you can pitch in ideas, you know, where the young architect, budding architects, they can go and pitch in your ideas and can get seed fundings for your interesting ideas. Actually, that's how the platform helps you. So
anybody
can do that. So any research, you require some amount of proper diagnosis, and then you jot down the prescriptions. Here, the diagnosis what we made, the city, basically like a city like Bangalore, we've taken up that. And we did a lot of study, like, you know, I'll explain you. Area of study, we have limited to the Bangalore. It's a complete urban area. The population in, because this chart, this slide will give you an information on the population 2011. This we did it in 2014-15. So that is when we took all this data and statistics. So it's a population we took. And
basically, it was a study of the current density study of Bangalore. Yes. And what are the problems faced due to this urban sprawl and the population in Bangalore? What are the issues we have? So some of the issues only we selected, because of course there are too many issues, many issues in a metropolitan city. So we were studying some of the key issues that we can probably resolve: population and urban sprawl.
And also we are looking at a lot of issues on the land cost, and because land cost was too high and the rental values are really, really high. So that is when, like, you know, we thought of how to.
But there are some vacant sites.
Yeah, a lot of vacant sites
in the city where the people are using it just to dump garbage, and the owners are probably not around to take care of the site. They are living elsewhere.
Yeah, Bangalore Urban Development Authority had an rules saying that, you know, you can't leave your vacant, like, you know, allotted plots more than 10 years vacant. So, but no one was practicing all that, you know, seriously. You know, according to their rules, you know, they have to, like, you know, we have to surrender the land to them. They'll confiscate the land. That's how it was. But unfortunately, that is not really implemented. It was there as a law. That's it.
And there is the issue that before the lockdown, at least, that people had to travel long distances for their work. So there was a traffic congestion. Their workplace will be elsewhere, and the place where they live is elsewhere.
The person residing in JP Nagar, he'll be working in somewhere in Whitefield or somewhere. You know, he has to commute a lot on a daily basis. So that was really.
Is there a solution that can get all this together? Is something we were working on. And as you can see, these images on the right, the population of Bangalore has been increasing every year by year, it has been increasing. We know this. And most of the population is actually people coming from outside the city.
A lot of migration. That was really, that time it was like, yeah, as you can see the chart, it is clearly tells you 7 lakhs and 5.44 in 1991, 2001. It was like really.
The natural increase is quite less. It says only 2.66 became 3.42, but the in migration was a large,
large number. Before. This is 6 years before story. So I'm just refreshing it today. And maybe it would have gone ahead. So up to 2010, if you look at the chart, like, you know, urban sprawl, like, you know, you can see the red patch really, really going.
Has been spreading. So these are some of the things.
And also, if you look at the pollutions, because people used to travel a lot and commute a lot, I mean, a lot of distance for their workplaces. And that is because of that, you know, a lot of pollution. And also,
sad story of how cows have to eat the plastic which is
dumped. We also observed another business entity started at that time, like, you know, property management. Consultancies, like, you know, because people own lands and they'll be residing somewhere far away from the city or from in other countries. So they used to monitor the site. You know, they used to, you know, employ an agency who going to monitor. So you know, that was another business started. So traffic congestion is and this is quite commonly seen.
Many vacant sites.
Next part, another issue, what client has to, like, you know, they have to keep on paying taxes, like property tax is mandatory, whether you're going to build or not, you're going to use the premises or not, you have to pay the tax. Okay, and that is another overhead for clients, I mean, the customers, people who own the lands, in fact. And I already mentioned the Vacancy Period Act. That is the BDA had an issue, like, you know, within 5 to 10 years, if you fail to build, then they will take the land back. But it is not really implemented. And we did another research on rental values. Like, you know, it is on a chart, like in a bar chart shows.
Different areas, yes. What is the value you get per square feet as a rent, as an average rental? So that really varies between land cost and rental values vary between area and area. So which are the areas where you would get a higher rent for a particular built structure? Because cost of construction anywhere in the city is nearly the same. It will not vary significantly if it is in city limits. But the rental revenue one generates from that varies substantially. So this was a issue because everyone wants to build. Many clients wanted to build to generate rental income, but there was this discrepancy where to build to get better income.
If you build in Anekal or any faraway suburban areas of Bangalore, the construction cost remains same. You know, the rental value always differ. That was an issue. So if you build the same building near somewhere near prime area like CBDs like MG Road or somewhere, the rental value is quite high. The cost of construction remain as it is. So how to resolve, like, you know, how to. So these are the inference we jotted down from that, whatever we have explained. So then we came up with a prescription, like something like value proposition. So
why not have a concept where there is a mobile shelter provider?
You don't need to build any house, in fact, on a land. You can even store this house in your, maybe you can have a house in your loft or something like that.
You can store the house. It's a transformable sort of a house. You can store it in your terrace area or in your loft or your storage in your house if you're the shelter provider. And you can just go and place it on a vacant site whenever such a necessity arises. If somebody wants a house, that time the house is erected. So that was the kind of a concept that was proposed. Everyone doesn't need to own a land to build. So the owner of the land is different, the builder is different, and it's a tri-party arrangement. The owner is just going to give the land, the vacant site. So since right now he's not generating any income from his vacant site, he is ready to lease out his vacant site. At the same time, the person who is providing the shelter, he does not probably have the land. He have any land, but he wants to become an entrepreneur. He wants to
generate some revenue out of that entire exercise. So not only that, you know, it is not only limited to that. Even the people who are not really exceeded their built-up areas, maybe they have not exceeded, if they have only ground floor or something like that, they have built and they don't want to build, because the building always undergo depreciations. Like, you know, if you build a house today, the cost of it may be approximately, let's say, will take up 1 crore. Eventually, you know, by 10, 20 years, the bankers will evaluate it to 25, after 25 years, they will evaluate it to zero, in fact, or maybe 10, 15 lakhs, that's all. So the depreciation is very, very high. So by the time you know, even your rental will not subside this, you know, the depreciation. So that is a really, really big issue. Because so then we thought of actually even extending this idea to the people who have not really expanded their house to the maximum built up areas. Like, you know, if they're not FARs. So let's say, for example, like, you know, they have a person with only one ground floor built. They don't need to build another floor on top of it. These kind of temporary structures can be erected on this thing, on this temporary, I mean, on these terraces. That was another idea over there. So
and it's all connected through a central platform, which is the Symbiotic Shelter platform. They will connect these three entities. So that was the value proposition. Same thing graphically represented here. So landlord is there with a vacant site, and there's a person who's building the shelters. These are mobile shelters, and there's a tenant. And it is just simply transported and placed on the vacant site.
Yeah. And also, we are talking about wrappable structures today, and we can even wrap it. You know, we don't need to assemble it like a prefab structures. So we can even, like, you know, the wrappable structures are something like a very compact. We can actually store it in your maybe in your terrace or something like that. It's very interesting topic.
So how we went about doing this? We did a study. This is the pricing model. So
The cost of construction will also come down drastically in these cases because with kind of material used and the kind of
mass production
and also the scrap value of the product. So the scrap value is like clearly like 75% used to get back. So that was a plus point of that project basically. And we have done in a different sectors, like, you know, we have a residential builds and we have a commercial builds and we also have a public spaces like galleries and all. We have designed in, I mean,
this might really work for, suppose somebody wants to stay near their workplace for a short period of time, or maybe for a long period of time, or they want a spare house next to their place of work, or maybe for a commercial establishment which just wants to try whether their business model is going to work in that area, whether an eatery will work in that area. I want to try, I can go for this. Rather than doing the interiors, doing everything and completely establishing it and then understanding that it is not going to work, it's not suitable. So it gives a lot of opportunity for various people and even for co-sharing.
Currently a lot of like startups and all that. I mean, not only for startups, like a lot of incubators and maybe co-sharing communities, like, so they opt for such kind of a premises. That is how we started.
We did a sort of a study of different areas
and rental area.
The rental revenue that can be generated from these areas, where this proposition will work best.
And we came up with some models, like, you know, we came up with some modular housing models.
Where we have one service module and, like, basically they all get attached to each other.
So each block, so you can actually, you know, each block, so you can connect it. And we can each, it just takes a day time to assemble the entire system, entire house, a 1 BHK house, basically.
On how we can place it on different,
elements of different plot sizes, around, if you take up 40, 16. I mean, specifically, we are, you know, all these things are more towards the sites which are there in the urban areas like Bangalore. So we usually come to the 40, 60 site and 50, 80, these are sites.
We did a study for one particular ward, that is JP Nagar ward 177, and actually we tried establishing contact with the owners just to see whether, you know, how far this will work out, what is their opinion, and how people react to this kind of idea, because anything that is new, people tend to be a little skeptic about it. So we just wanted to see what people feel. So we identified what are the sites that are vacant in this complete area, and we did it in a very interesting exercise using the help of the post.
Postal department.
So we went to them, and it's quite easy because you will know the owner. See, it's all about. We cannot, like, you know, we cannot patent the ideas. Basically, we can only patent the technology. Okay, so how to what is the key of your business? What is the key of your ideas? Basically, that is the whole challenge. So we took help of the postal department to identify the vacant sites and the owners, because it's very difficult to get the owner, like, you know, owner's contacts. That's the biggest challenge. So we did all that through a postal department. We came up with an interesting business model. So where we can able to, like, the entire research helped us, like, you know, architecturally also, like.
We can see how to reduce the quantity of build itself. Like, we don't need to unnecessarily build where it's not required, and it can exactly be there till the need is there for it. So suppose tomorrow this client is not, this person, this tenant is not going to stay here, the house can move to a different location. So what happens eventually is you reduce the quantity of build within the city. Here we have established contacts, and we try to talk to them and see people are they open to such an idea, because it's a new idea, and people might not want to. Some people did not want to have these kind of structures on their. They're worried, like, what if their land is taken away? But some others were more open to it. And of course, all this takes time. So eventually, if they see three other people in the area opting for this method, then people accept it. So yeah, I think that is about this particular project.
I mean to say, like, you know, we have done a lot of research in different areas. Like, as an architect, we don't have to, like, all the time restrict ourselves with brick and mortar or some techniques, or we have to work beyond that. That is what I learned from, you know, the IIM basically. So it's not about only like, you know, because all the design, whatever you do, we keep on improving. Like, you know, innovations are really, really helpful.
Kind of give out your message here is research is actually a very necessary tool for innovation, whether in architectural design schools or whether it's in your practice. Research can provide the direction to move forward and it can increase the efficiency of your design. Because what is next if you don't go in a certain path? How do you progress? How do you choose between ideas? So it gives you this kind of a direction and it gives more meaning and value to the work.
So how this research part really help us in practice. So that was our topic today.
One of beautiful works there. Thank you, Gautama and Janani. It was amazing, knowing you, knowing your passion and knowing the way, the path you've taken. I'm quite happy that a lot of youngsters are really moving towards sustainability as a medium of expression. And so happy to have you present your works today. Wishing you all the very best and looking forward for some amazing times together, also with Hampi Center of Design, exploring unexplored areas of sustainability.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. And we also thank Hampi Center for Design for giving us such a wonderful opportunity to share our ideas to people. And
it was a very nice connection with the audience.
Right. Thank you. I shall be ending this session.